Hello there! In this tutorial, I will explain the basics about making natural looking shadows. Knowing Photoshop well doesn't necessarily mean that one is good at making artificial shadows in the right color, or one has the skills to work with perspective according to the perspective rules. I will cover these subjects in this tutorial that therefore is divided into chapters. One about finding the right color, one about perspective and shape, and one about how different light sources affect the softness of shadows. Finally, we will combine these three shadow characteristics in Photoshop. If you for any reason want to skip some of this rather comprehensive tutorial, the timecode for these chapters will be in the description below. Let's get started. There seems to be some misconceptions about the colors of shadows and what makes them look realistic. F-stoppers and Peter Pixels even had articles and videos about how to remove the blue cast from shadows in snow, but in 95% of cases, at least outdoors on horizontal surfaces, shadows are blue, not gray. And on white surfaces like snow, it's very easy to see. But why are they blue? Let's start with some color theory and a little science that explains why blue is the prominent color in shadows. There is actually two reasons for this. One is physical and one is happening in our brain. On the middle of the day, the color of the sun seems close to white, but near sunset and sunrise, the sunbeams have to travel through a lot more atmosphere. The more enduring long wave colors, red and orange, survive this journey more than the shorter waves like blue and violet. That is why the sun gets more orange when getting closer to the horizon, and sometimes even red just before it hits the horizon. The long wave colors don't change direction so easily when they bump into all the dust and particles in our atmosphere, but the short wave colors, blue and violet, do, and are therefore scattered out in the entire atmosphere. This is actually why the sky is blue in daytime, a sky that is virtually transparent during nighttime. Well, that was a long story, only to explain that the colors of the sun is connected to its altitude. And the colors in snow on a clear winter day, and with the sun not too high above the horizon, are pale orange. And our eyes, or should I say our brain, have this perfect white balance tool that compensate a little for this orange cast, and the shadows seems therefore even more blue. In color theory and in art, this phenomenon is called simultaneous contrast, which means that every color creates its own complementary color. Look at these examples. Which of the two cubes have the brightest front? Well, you might have guessed, they are the same neutral gray, and here we have a letter A and a shadow looking slightly blue. Well, you might have figured this one out as well. It's the exact same gray as before, no color tint whatsoever. Please let me know if you actually could see that. The point is, you cannot trust your own eyes when it comes to judging colors. Colors seem more vibrant in a complementary environment, and you need to know this phenomenon to be able to make good-looking shadows. The second reason why shadows are blue is the simple fact that if you crawled into one of those shadows, the only light source you would see is the blue sky above. But there are of course exceptions when the colors are not blue, especially on vertical surfaces like these columns on this terrace. We have blue here near the opening because of the direct view to the sky above. But in here, a green tint is more present. Again, if you crawled into that shadow, the green grass would be what was shining on you. And back here, light brown, the reflected color of a wooden table lit by the sun. On vertical surfaces, we have much higher variety of colors than we have on horizontal surfaces. This photo was actually taken at the same time and place, but on a horizontal surface. The color is heavily blue, almost violet, with only a tiny reflection from the color of my skin. Violet because the only thing above is the clear sky, and the color is the shortest visible wavelength our eyes can register. If it becomes even shorter, we reach ultraviolet, and that's invisible for human eyes. I have one more example on how colors can change in shadows. This time we are indoors in my kitchen. My white cupboard has bluish colors here, orange colors here, and very dark in the top. These strange shifts are because the windows work like a big lens, like a camera obscura, and the colors from outside are projected upside down. Indoors in general, colors are mostly neutral. They can, of course, have any given color. It depends on the light sources and the reflected colors of walls and ceilings, but in apartments and houses with white walls and ceilings, they are often rather gray. So let's jump outside again. We now know that shadows are mainly blue, but how can we tell on surfaces of different colors than white? Here we have a tan or beige colored building and some nice shadows down here. Let's put in this neutral gray reference box and then turn on this curves white balance layer I made in advance. The image looks of course a little off after we neutralized the colors of the building. But we revealed that blue is still the primary color in the shadows here as well. Now with this knowledge about shadow colors, it's much easier to figure out how to make our own shadows. Time to work a little in Photoshop and look into the pros and cons of a few different shadow making methods. Here we have a photo of a real shadow and a photo without the shadow where I manipulated the milk back in. We can now try to recreate the shadow colors as precisely as possible. But first we have to make a selection with a polygonal lasso tool to isolate the shadow area. Like that. And we start with the easiest method. A hue saturation adjustment layer, where we tick colorize, and a little down in lightness. As you can see, we have no color information in the shadow. Let's first find the right blue and then choose blending mode multiply, otherwise our shadow will be monochrome. This method is very easy to control because of the three simple sliders, but it can be a little bit too contrasty. In the next method, we use a photo filter adjustment layer and reuse the mask. We don't have to change blend mode this time, we only have to match the color, but that can be a little trickier than in the first method. Dial up the density and don't tick preserve luminosity. I used the color sampler tool and the info palette to be sure we match the exact color. I actually used the color sampler tool in all the examples so I better can compare. This is not so contrasty, but if we use multiply again, we gain a little contrast. The last example is a curves adjustment layer, where we adjust the red, green and blue channels separately. A very strong tool if we have to match the numbers precisely. We can keep an eye on the output numbers if we know a specific blue we want to achieve. And as I will demonstrate now, it's very easy to match the exact colors by the numbers in the info palette. Let's grab the color sampler tool, open the info palette. The exact numbers are 103, 129, and 183. And we simply correct them one at a time. Red, 103. Green, 129. And blue, 182. Or was it 183? Well, never mind. If we want a little variation in the shadow, a little darker near the milk, we can double the adjustment layer with Command J and dab a little with a soft black brush in the mask. And dial down the opacity for a more natural look. Well, that was three different ways of creating a cast shadow. I know the hue saturation method is not as precise as the two others, but I still use it if I just have to make a quick shadow on a simple colored surface like a pavement or a road. But what on overcast days? Actually, we don't have any direct light sources, only light coming from all over the sky. And because of that, we almost have no cast shadow, only a drop in light intensity. And that leads us to the next chapter, the shape of the shadow. It can be very tricky to predict the shape of a shadow from a three-dimensional object in a two-dimensional flat environment. And to illustrate this, I have prepared a little guessing game. I have this photo of a stick where I erased the cast shadow. Look closely. Can you predict how the shadow looks? Let's give it a few seconds. And here it is with the original shadow. Probably not how you figured it. Please let me know in the comments if you were anywhere near that shape. Now that we are warmed up, let's take one more example. And let's give this one a few seconds too. And here with the original shadow. Even a cast shadow from a simple stick can be close to impossible to predict. And I often see skilled Photoshoppers make mistakes in this part of the manipulation process. The most common mistake in the shadow making process is when you just reselect the subject and use this selection in a perspectively distorted version to create a shadow. I know it's a very quick and easy way, but sometimes it goes on near two-dimensional objects like this more or less flat bike, or on real two-dimensional shapes like these letters. But as soon as the subject has a more complicated three-dimensional shape, it's not a sufficient method. Let's try this quick method again. Here's an image of my son Otto with his arms spread out and a simple background to cover the real environment. Let's reselect the mask by pressing Command on the mask, add a hue saturation layer, tick Colorize, and a blue hue, lightness down, Command T to transform, and hold Command while transforming, move up a little, enter, and some more green in the blue tint, press B for brush, and erase this part of the mask with black, and in properties, feather the mask non-destructively. Do you think it looks okay? Well, here is the original shadow with no arms. The problem is, we didn't imagine ourselves being in that shadow. The shape of the shadow always looks as the object seen from the perspective of the light source or from the shadow, and therefore, in this case, with no arms. That's also why we had this weird staircase-shaped shadow in our first example earlier. It's perfectly streamlined when seen from above, and this little tip is just the top corner of the milk box. Time to look at the different kind of shadows. We have only been looking at cast shadows until now. We have this red car, and we need three shadows to make it look real. Let's begin with the cast shadow we know so well. We make it with the polygonal lasso tool and the wheel and the top and a solid color fill layer. There are so many ways to create shadows. Let's make it blue and convert it for smart filters, blend mode multiply, opacity down, 55 is okay, and blur gallery, tilt shift blur, and we can make the shadow softer at the longer distance here. Let's make it even more pale, and time for the next shadow. This shadow is always there, also on overcast days. A drop in light intensity. We can use a photo filter and let's find the right color. And a little less color, like that. And this we need to soften a lot with the non-destructive feather slider. For the last shadow, the contact shadow, we can use a regular lasso tool to draw around the tires. The contact shadow is actually what we have just under our feet all the time. Again, we use a photo filter, a dark blue, and a little softness. Now the car is really grounded, and we can still adjust the shadows individually if we want. But did we forget the windows in the cast shadow? No, the angle of the sun is too high for windows to be seen. But what about the graduated softness I created on the cast shadow? Well, this is the content of the next chapter, softness. But when and where is the shadow soft? Well, one thing is sure, a shadow doesn't fade out as the distance grows. And as I recently saw in a very famous Photoshopper's tutorial, I recreated it here and it's not the right way to go. A shadow would only look like this if a bright light was bouncing back into the shadow. Look at this shadow from a parking sign. It gets softer when the distance gets longer. Let's look into some examples that explains why. The size of the light source always determines the softness of the shadow. The size as seen from the object casting the shadow. This little sun is not so big, but big enough for a visible penumbra. Of course, the halo around the sun is also a part of the shining area. Another way of showing it, if you move around a flashlight, the shadow moves accordingly. But if you instead had three flashlights, the umbra would be small and the penumbra would be on both sides. Combined in a softbox, the shadow would be very soft. As seen from the shadow angle, the small light here would reach 100% very quickly, and a bigger light would increase in intensity more gradually. We just have to bust a little myth too. When I teach photography, I often see people trying to soften the light with a little piece of diffusion material. It's actually not getting softer, just more pale because of the reflection from walls and ceilings. Outside or in a black painted room, it would have no effect. Only size matters when it comes to soft shadows. Now that we have looked into the color, shape and softness of shadows, we are at the doorstep of the last chapter. I hope you are a little wiser now than before, and I would be really glad if you would support my channel by subscribing. We only miss some practical use in Photoshop. We will dive into some of my previous and some of my future tutorials. First one here is from my toy car tutorial. The link is in the description below. And this is the blurry dark shadow you often see under a car, a bed or a table. It's very simple to create because we often only have to make a perspective rectangle that follows the shape of, in this case, the toy car. Then a fill layer or an adjustment layer. The rest is a non-destructive blur controlled with the feather slider in the properties panel and perhaps some opacity adjustments. The second example here is from my spin blur path blur case where I simulate a driving car in the sunset. We use a real shadow for reference when making the fake shadow and the sun for the perspective lines. The third example is from a future tutorial, the giant monkey. We take this monkey and place it in front of the city hall of Copenhagen. It's actually shot in the same light as the city hall, but on a white background with the shadow intact. we can select this shadow with the quick selection tool and use this selection to create a photo filter adjustment layer. Let's turn up density and find a blue color. And then turn off the original shadow and a higher density. Some more violet in the blue. And with a white brush in the mask, we can quickly clean up this simple mask based on the original shadow. If we turn off the photo filter, I can show another quick way to create a shadow based on the real shadow. We have a white background, but let's make it even more white with the destructive version of levels, Command L. And then choose Blend Mode Multiply. The white is gone, and if we press Alt or Option while adding a mask, we get a black mask, and we can paint back the shadow where we want it. As long as we have the real shadow on a white background, we can reuse it no matter how complex it is. Here we have a rather complicated shadow on a white piece of paper. I made a selection in advance, and we can make a copy of the glass with Command J. With the Move tool, we can move the glass outside the paper. And with Polygonal Lasso tool, we can cut out the shadow as well. Make a copy with Command J again, and move this shadow underneath the new glass. If we choose Multiply, we have a perfect shadow that can easily be moved around. There are so many ways of creating shadows, but now we have reached the last example of this tutorial. One where we use two drop shadows and a curves adjustment layer. We will hang these three boxes on the wall. And we start by drawing directional shapes to simulate the very soft cast shadow. Add a curves layer and drag it down in the middle. And then a lot of feather. Then we go to the effect panel and a drop shadow. We have to make the blue more neutral. Let's just remove the previous effect and start all over. First we find the right direction, like that, and then just a little distance and softness. This shadow needs to be very subtle. We can add a second drop shadow, even smaller, so the boxes really touches the wall. Before and after. Well, that was all for today. I really hope you learned something. If you did, please like, subscribe, add a comment, or ring that bell for future notifications. Thank you and goodbye. By the way, my next long tutorial will be about making natural reflections, so please stay tuned.